DJ AM, also known as Adam Goldstein, a gastric bypass survivor. Success story. And we're going to walk through a crack binge. Okay, because I think crack binges are really interesting in terms of illustrating how powerful the disease of addiction is.
Yes, they are. And so, yes, I'm a crackhead. Former.
So here you go. So
a crackhead sober.
Let's describe the scene. When you start out on a crack binge, okay, not your very first binge, but you're just a general. Just
when you're in the crackiness,
a routine
when you're already
binge.
A smoker.
Are you by yourself? When you start
yes.
out, when you
yes.
start out by yourself,
yes.
Would you ever start out with other people?
At the beginning, I did.
You other
turned,
people.
The disease turned
right.
into me wanting to really.
All right, well, let's start when you're with another group of people.
Okay.
So you were first hit, right?
Yep.
How was that?
It's very much like an orgasm.
Amazing. Okay. How about your second and third hit?
In the same night we're talking
same
about.
Night.
Same night.
Second hit, third hit.
They're still, you know, it's
still
that same, that burst of, you know, euphoria.
But
it doesn't last as long.
Starts to wear off.
It starts to wear off quicker.
Now, you've been on a binge 800 times,
mm-hmm.
and so you know it's going to go like that.
Yes.
You know it's going to be only good for the first few hits.
Correct.
Where does it start not feeling really much good at all? How many hits in, would you say? How many hours in?
As long as you have it, it doesn't not feel good.
Mm.
It's when it's all gone to me. It didn't start feeling good.
Didn't you start?
It started feeling a lot less powerful.
Didn't you start thinking strange things eventually?
Oh, absolutely. You start hearing things.
That doesn't.
You
doesn't
hear
sounds. That doesn't feel good.
No, definitely not.
Okay, so you know you're going to that.
Oh,
when you take that first hit, you know you're going into that state.
Absolutely. Literally 5 seconds after, say, the fifth hit is what you're asking about.
Yeah.
I guess after, you know, the fifth one, right away from the first one for me, but, you know, 5 seconds after you take the hit, after you exhale it, the paranoia for me would set in.
So you immediately get paranoid. Okay.
Beyond paranoid.
Okay. So now let's say we're a day in. You started out with a group of people. Are they still around?
No, not at all.
You're by yourself.
Yeah.
You're in a bay windows well lit room with the curtains open?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
Quite the opposite.
You've got a room, curtains closed.
Curtains closed.
Foil on the windows.
Foil on the windows. Blankets,
door,
barred tables.
You're in the
it.
Closet.
Yes.
With a single light bulb and a crack pipe.
No light bulb.
No light bulb. Dark in the closet.
Blanket. Yes.
What are you hiding from?
From the imaginary people that are coming to get you.
And what are those people wearing?
White coats, police uniforms.
Uniforms.
Yeah.
There's an absolutely characteristic paranoia with cocaine, which is uniformed officials.
Yes.
SWAT, Army, FBI, people coming to get...
Coming to take me away.
Huh? And you would look out the window and see them. Where would they be? We're in Southern
Hiding
California.
Hiding in the bushes.
In the bushes. Always in the bushes or
always.
In the palm trees is the other one I get.
Yeah. Or you hear them on the roof.
So it's the strangest thing about cocaine is it causes an absolutely characteristic paranoia. Police, FBI, SWATs, Army coming for you. You board everything up.
Mm-hmm.
You get paranoid as hell. And then you can even start hearing things. Like Tom Arnold was telling me when he got really, really paranoid. He believed that the officers were across the mirror from him. We'd look in the mirror. And one day they told him to pull the white off his eye. It was a good idea to cut that off. To pull the white off and cut off.
That's one of the more insane things I've ever heard.
That's a good one, right?
And
that's
I cocaine. Know we've talked about this before. That's crazy.
And the deal is that I find that's, again, illustrative of the power of this thing. When you decide to take that first hit, you know you're going to be in the closet feeling like hell.
Yes. Yes.
You know it. You've done it 500 times.
I just spoke about this earlier this evening. About I remember, you know, saying after the same night, you know, going home after work when I'd know I didn't want to end up in the same thing. And I'd say, I'm not going to do it tonight. I'm not going to go downtown and I'm not going to cop and I'm not going to go home, board up the windows and end up with that same feeling when it runs out of misery and paranoia. And I would say, and I'd go home and I'd get on the couch and take off my shoes and go, I'm not going. I'm not going. I'm not going. And I'd watch TV, not going. Half an hour goes by, I start putting on my shoes and I'm going, I'm not going. Next thing I'm in my car and I'm driving and I'm crying, going, I'm not going, and I'm punching the steering wheel because it wasn't me driving that car.
Right.
You know, my disease had taken fully over. I had no tools to stop me
right.
from going down there and getting it, because with crack, it's a mental obsession. I couldn't get
it's
that
a brain.
Out
it's
of
a
my
brain
head
thing.
Until my brain got fed
and,
the food.
And what I was telling AM was that laboratory animals do the exact same thing.
That's amazing.
All mammals behave their relationship with high doses of cocaine the same way. They refuse everything else, food, sexual objects, socialization. They must. And there's actually a specific concentration of dopamine that needs to be achieved in the brain
really?
From the cocaine. And these animals will do anything
to get that.
To maintain it.
Yeah,
not just get it, but maintain it. There.
I have been humbled and brought through, you know, it was a painful, miserable, terrible way to live. You know? And I am so lucky and grateful and blessed to be as clean as long as I have. You know, I really am to come back from that, because I really thought it wasn't going to end. It ended for me with, you know, a gun in my mouth. I was pulling the trigger. I mean, it was on its way down, you know. I couldn't look at myself for a long time. One night I did the routine, threw away the pipe and was, you know what, I can't do this anymore. I'm just going to end it all.
And what happened?
A moment of clarity.
Yeah.
You know, a moment of God in my head saying, this is not where it ends for me. This is not all my life has amounted to. I'm not going out like some crackhead who shoots himself. I can't do that. That's not who I am. And thank God there were, you know, people there to help me.
That is the one thing that I've seen repeatedly that guarantees somebody, not guarantee, but puts somebody on the road to recovery, which is believing they're going to die if they don't stop,
mm-hmm.
or total disgust. The disgust is not quite as powerful as the belief that I'm going to die and I don't want to.
Yeah.
But you have to be right there.
Once I actually did die, I mean, my heart,
had a cardiac stop.
My heart stopped. And when I woke up, I took a humongous hit, and I remember it had been a long night and, you know, smoking crack all night. And I remember when I came out of it and I realized I was, and I saw myself out of my body.
Wow.
I saw myself on the couch in this disgusting apartment with barf everywhere and no power and chip cell phones as the home phone in the wall. And I saw my body there. And I remember when I snapped back into it and I woke up and I looked out, I started bawling my eyes out because I didn't die. Yeah. And I think that was the most painful thing, was realizing that I really wanted to
you
die.
Were.
When I realized I was still alive, I was like, oh, I was so, you know.
That's one of the more dangerous parts of addiction, is that if you don't care.
Yeah.
We were talking about that Jeff Conaway thing I did.
Mm-hmm.
He had that kind of,
really?
I don't care for that.
God.
And that's
so sad.
Yeah, that's bad.
That is bad. That is the saddest place.
But when you
place.
Can care and when you believe you're going to die, you'll get well.
Yeah. Yes.
But you have to yes. kind of want to live. Even
yes.
just a little bit.
A little ounce of willingness.
Yes.
An ounce of willingness to try.
When you know that without changing direction,
yes, you're not going to make it. Yes, absolutely.
Thank you. Very interesting. Well, thank you for that.